Last time I was here, you had talked about doing some commercial and licensing work. Do you still do that?
Yep, I do a bit. It's not so much like TV ads. So I've done a few ads.
Okay.
I work with like production companies to do videos. It can be anything. It could be TV stuff that's in Cineplex, stuff that's online. I did one recently for the university. Is it Simon Fraser University out west?
Yeah.
For a department there. So that was for a production.
That's cool.
Company. So yeah, stuff like that.
Do you enjoy doing that, or is it just about the paycheck so that you can do more creative stuff? Or can you be creative doing that?
Well, I can. I do enjoy it. It isn't just about. It does pay, maybe sort of better than if you're like producing an indie band for
sure. Totally.
Which is by far the most fulfilling thing, you know.
Totally.
But also the most time consuming.
Yeah.
But you can be creative in it. And I started off, people got in contact with me and said, hey, could you mix this? And could you maybe compose a bit of music to it and mix in the dialogue and stuff like that? And I was thinking, even could you choose a track?
Hmm.
So it's not necessarily composition. You become effectively a music supervisor. You have to think about what the brand is saying, how long the track is, the feel of the music.
Yeah.
And then songwriting comes into it. So at first I was like, why did you get me to do something like that? You know, like, it doesn't seem that hard. Even if it's library music, like just choose something.
Right.
But the more I did it, the more I got versions of things where it would come with the editors of like throwing some music in.
Hmm.
So it is kind of more homegrown.
Yeah.
They had thrown some music in, leveled it, whatever. But sometimes I would choose a different track that they would just prefer. I also manipulate the music quite a bit.
Okay.
And so very quickly I learned actually there is a real advantage in having someone that understands what's the journey for a start. You have to understand the brand and what they're trying to say, so that even picking, even knowing very quickly what genre to just jump to, you think this would be, you've saved a ton of time that, you know, someone else might be scrambling around.
That's true.
Listening stuff from all over.
Yeah.
So you can be creative within those boundaries, and you know, I might manipulate the track, so you might chop it halfway as it sort of fades out and then bring it back in and you know, somewhere else, where someone else might have just played the whole track through.
Right.
I also do something if the budget isn't there to compose, which is a bit of a hybrid setup, where I will specifically source a track that has a lot of room in it. So I did something for, there's a production company, Story Stream, and we were doing some work for Porsche. So I did a series of videos. For one of the videos, I chose a music bed that was quite ambient, organic. It reminded me of Sigur Rós.
Okay.
And I love Sigur Rós.
Yeah. So,
but it was sparse enough that I wanted something to happen at the end. I wanted it to be more emotive and more powerful. And so, you know, you find the tempo. It was just basically like strings, pads, guitars.
Right.
So I then recorded drums.
Oh, wow. You know,
pounding drums over end. Much bigger.
That's cool.
Chords on the guitar.
Yeah.
A synth in there and stuff like that. Building up to a big crescendo and then sort of off at the end.
Yeah.
And it really transformed the end of the track, which is exactly what I wanted to hear, but I couldn't find
interesting the track. I didn't
to
know
do that.
That.
So and that's so, a hybrid.
And you can do that like with licensing? Like the artist, the original track wouldn't mind or?
Yeah, it's you're basically creating a sort of a different version. Yeah. Your composite. Because of course
still getting paid.
It has vocal, it has dialogue all over it, right?
Right.
And a lot of them you would put sound effects. Sound design over stuff.
Right.
Some of my sound design elements I might even fit with the tempo of the track and even the key.
Okay.
So if I have a little Glock in there or something to a bit of a flair thing going on.
Yeah.
Might be in time with the music or whatever, and it sort of jumps out and then goes back in again.
Yeah.
At the end of some of those tracks, you might create a little audio hook, an audio ID.
Right.
And that you got to have a fairly musical ear for, because you listen into the track, you think, okay, this has got strings, it's got some violins in it, it's got Glock, a marimba, or whatever.
Yeah.
And then you bring up your soft synths, virtual instruments, match the sounds, and then as that track fades out, you sort of mix in a little audio ID at the end.
That's cool.
And I don't know whether, I don't know a ton of people that do that sort of thing, but it's something that I've offered that people have been really happy with when they can't afford full composition.
Yeah.
But they want to step up from just someone else might have used this track. So
if you're using a track that anyone has access to and is something that wasn't composed for the video, but there are still elements of the video where you want it to climax and there's some dynamics in that video that
that's where I would say being a songwriter, understanding a journey of a song, what that means, being sensitive to, well, in the song it would be the subject matter, and in the video it could be the brand.
So, sorry, I want to interrupt you because you said something about this licensing thing or recording an indie band being the most fulfilling, even though it doesn't pay you the most. What part of this whole process do you enjoy the most? Not necessarily licensing, but recording.
Recording. Creating sounds. So using the studio, which I would say, you know, like I said, I didn't grow up in a studio. I didn't grow up following someone around, like making them tea, plugging in microphones.
Yeah.
I was almost, I mean, we all are now, this generation, we've almost just missed that.
Totally.
A lot of people our age that are producers might have gone to school, but it certainly wasn't the case where we just like look for a job as a runner. No, that totally doesn't happen anymore.
Totally.
So so I've missed all that. So I wouldn't say that I'm technically as gifted as some engineers. Mm-hmm. You know, I phone up engineers and say, what would you do in this situation? What would you do in that situation? Yeah. What mic would you use here? Whatever. But I love creating, and being a songwriter, that's like one of the things. Creativity is king.
Yeah.
So getting a band in, and I did this a lot with Matt Henson and Old English, as well as Fitness Club Fiasco.
Right.
Getting synths in, like, what do you put synths through? Like, you've got a synth you could plug straight into the sound card. Let's put it through some pedals. Let's put it through.
I'm with you. That's the exciting part.
Yeah. That really is for me. Like, and then basically just don't mess it up.
Yeah.
Get a mic.
Yeah.
Get your favorite mic that you like. Don't record too hot. Like, yes, you can put it through some compression or whatever. Like, sometimes that's the sound you go for, but just don't stuff it up. Just get it into the box.
Yeah.
And then you can manipulate it and play with it more in the box. But yeah, we had stuff going on, like little quirky little keyboards through delay pedals through, and then I had hired a 414, put it in Omni, put two amps, you know, sort of facing it. One was delayed, one wasn't, one was crunchy, nice, one wasn't, and nice, you know, you sort of work out where the best position is and get a sound that is.
And what's great about that is that everyone may have the same keys or keyboard or synth that you're using, or have access to one, and everyone has the same interface.
Yeah.
But not really is it too common that they say they choose the same path when you know of the this delay pedal and this compressor into this amp, into paired with this amp with this mic. That's where you can really stand out in music, because really just any one of these synths, they sound great, but if it's something that everyone's doing, what's going to make you sound different?
Yeah, and that's the fun part. That's what I remember from recording. We went into, when I was in a band, we recorded in some pretty cool places. One that sticks out was Rack Studios in London.
Oh, okay.
Which is like a bit of a legendary studio.
Totally.
So we were working with a good producer in there, and the things that, and you know, a couple of other producers as well in other studios, the things that I remember are the things that I, as a musician, I was like, that is the coolest thing ever. Like, yeah, you really? Can go in there, you can set your drums up,
yeah.
You get your guitar amps, they put them in a little booth and you come into the control room. And
yeah.
The things I remember are the little tricks and the things that I really
like what?
Found creative. So one would be, I might have spoken to you about this the last time you were over, but setting up a drum kit. And we played the take.
Okay.
So the drummer had played the take. Yeah. Then they set up orotones, similar to these. These aren't orotones. But similar to those. On the speaker stands, pointed them. One was at the snare. One was at the kick, I think. And then they from the transients, from the drum tracks,
yeah.
They would then trigger low frequency sound that they would send out through the orotones, and it would fire
like air,
air at the snare, and then they would record
the same snare that they recorded.
Yeah, like the drum kit.
Yeah.
And then obviously that would hit the skin. I think they loosened the snare for a amount to get more of a organic percussive sound, and then they would record the bottom snare. So you get the take with obviously the transients,
yeah.
But then you got this whoosh, over the top of it, this really cool sound. And the same with the kick, it was like
way.
This flab. It was unlike a sound I've ever heard. And they mixed this in with the track.
Yeah.
Plus at the same time, when Tom, our drummer, was taking, they had a feed of, I think it was kick and snare, that went into another booth through an old Selma, I think it was a Selma guitar amp.
Wow.
Really crunchy. But it was, the cool thing about it was, it wasn't post.
Yeah.
It was actually done at the same time, which was kind of cool. So,
that's so cool.
While he was playing, they were even in the booth, like, you know, they could hear Tom playing. They were getting the sound. It was really crunchy. And then, so that whole, I don't know, like it reminded me of like a Beck song or something. Like it was really vibey and just with all this, it was basically all this air, like it making the snare rattle and the bass
and
drum.
It also makes mixing go faster too, because you've made a lot of these decisions ahead of time.
Yeah.
That is really cool. I do remember you talking about that, but I didn't remember the specifics of it.
Well, because since then, I've taken that into what I do. So if I have a drum kit that I think, oh, this snare needs a bit of something.
Yeah.
I can't necessarily do it to a whole kit here, but I'll get my Vox amp again. What I might do is send the actual, duplicate the track.
Okay.
But manipulate it so it's all rolled off. The top end's rolled off, so it's kind of quite a low frequency thump.
Yeah.
Even EQ that duplicated track a bit, so it creates some more.
Okay.
Send it through to my Vox, lay my Vox pretty much down, like maybe put some duct tape underneath it.
Okay.
And then I'll just sit a snare on the Vox amp.
Yeah.
Snare up.
Okay.
Might chuck a tambourine on top. Might chuck some egg shakers in the tambourines.
And then a mic on top.
And then a mic on top.
What kind of mic? A dynamic or a condenser?
No, a condenser. Okay. Would do it with the condenser.
There's no other sounds happening.
Yeah, there's no other sounds. It's isolated. Yeah. So it's just, you know, get as much as you can.
And are you able to get that shot of air?
Yeah, so what I would do is I might put some tape, another duct tape or something to lift the snare up a bit, because you've got to get some sort of movement.
Okay. Yeah.
And record that. So I do that over a lot of drum machines. So if I've recorded like a 707, for instance, they're great sounds, but they're really punchy. They're quite
so
tight. I would send that out, and you add some organic sound particularly on the snare, without another hard transient, and it becomes this messy.
So what does the Vox sound like? Are you doing it as clean as possible on the Vox, or are you adding anything?
Well, see, that's the great thing. You just, whatever, like it, you can put more bass in and it creates more vibration, more like air movement.
Yeah.
Right? So it's all just playing
crazy.
It and take it by ear, really. Like,
well, I do remember you talking a little bit about that. I don't remember the specifics. I didn't remember that it was more about the air than the actual signal. But that got me thinking, and I remember we talked about that briefly, and that did get me thinking, and I love to do more experimental stuff. I love, if I have the inputs and I'm recording drums, I love to throw as many trash mics into the equation, especially with guitars. When I'm doing electric guitars, I have a couple of headphones that I've turned into mics.
Yep,
and
great.
And just so many, and I think not only does it give you some of that lo-fi sound that you try to do with plugins, but it, when you blend three or four mics together, the beefiness that you get from an electric, or when you do it with bass or with drums, is something that we always look for in gear or in plugins.
Yeah.
But you get it by multi-miking. And so I remember when you told me that a couple months ago, I had some drums that we had done, and I was just goofing off one day, and I routed the snare back out. And it's funny, when the process you're talking about is, it's so fun and creative, but you've now got to set this all up.
Yeah.
Then you've got to play the track full and print it.
Yeah.
And then you've got to do that for every song. So
yeah.
it's, but anyway, I
but it sounds amazing.
It sounds amazing. I know, it sounds so good.
And we get, the beauty is, as I guess independent producers, and now it's a different time, it's not so much money anymore.
Yeah, so, no, that's true. Yeah.
Even though, I mean, when we were doing that in that studio, our budget was pretty big.
Right.
It's probably like, you don't get budgets like that anymore. Yeah. But I remember it.
Oh,
right.
Man.
It's one of the things that, yeah, I'm like, I remember, I don't remember a lot of that stuff, but
right,
I remember those cool things. And so I will try and do something like that. Sometimes there's a time for, even when you've got the band in here, you need to just like,
yeah,
we need to get this done. Yeah. But I didn't enjoy those sessions. When I was working with a producer and engineer, and they were just a bit distant,
mm-hmm,
and they were like, can you just stop talking? Or can you just,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
okay, we need to get that done. Okay, rip that down. Let's do this. It was like, ugh, I didn't really enjoy it. I try not to be like that. Even if I think this sounds pretty good,
mm-hmm,
depending on who I'm working with, if I think, okay, well, let's do this, because,
yeah,
they might then go away and go, that was the coolest thing ever.
Well, and because you're talking about 10 years later, you remember it so,
yeah,
well. And I feel like as a producer and as an engineer, sometimes you know that a drum track or something sounds good, but you do need to sell the artist on it. You need the artist to be confident, because they're the ones who are going to be taking it on the road or selling the CD,
yeah,
or convincing their fans to buy this record. And so for them to have an experience like you had, and they'll say, when their friends ask, how is the recording process, they can really believe in that record that they've made because they've done some,
yeah,
of these memorable things.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Oh, it's cool. I mean, I would recommend to anyone to try it, but like, I want to try it the way you're talking, and I'm going to do it this weekend if I have some time. But what I did, which ended up is a far simpler way, a completely different sound, but I just took my snare sound,
mm-hmm,
and I ran it through an analog delay pedal. It's a mini little console that has a bucket,
yep,
brigade, but with a bit of delay, and then into a really, really crappy solid state amp that,
yep,
I have with a little bit of fuzz. And then I mic'd it, and I recorded that.
What did you mic it with?
You know, I can't remember at the time, but it was probably just an SM7, I think, because that's what was always in front of that mic,
right,
in front of that amp. But I ended up, and now thinking about it, I probably should have thrown up a condenser in the room too, or put it in front. But what was really cool about it was mixing that back in. That was that, you know, like that really,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
springy, slappy snare. And I mixed those drums just recently, and I kept it because it was not just because it was a cool thing, but it actually, when I muted it, I missed it, you know?
Yeah.
Well, that, but man, so much
that's
fun.
That's great. Yeah. You've sort of added another dimension of, you know, you've sort of brought it to life.
Totally.
And you've done stuff like that with the delays where actually it's a performance. So,
yeah.
So, you know, you used a delay in some of the, you could have, you know, sort of adjusted the delay time, the repeats,
yeah,
and you can do a couple of passes even, and I've done that where you've done a couple of passes of just crazy stuff,
yeah,
and then edited something together. It sounds like all the drums are falling apart, and
yeah,
then they,
oh,
come back.
So much fun.
It is fun. It's like you take something that's quite static and you make it quite sort of fluid.
And if you listen to records, I mean, I think of a record like Yankee Hotel Foxtrot from Wilco and some of the 90s Radiohead stuff. And there's tons of experimental music out there. And for a lot of us, not just engineers, but people who love music, some of our favorite parts in records are times where there's sounds that we can't identify. We don't know that is, but it's not just a melody or a lyric.
Absolutely. I mean, my favorite album of all time, maybe this is predictable, but it's OK Computer. Mm. Just because of the time of my life, it was 97, wasn't it? And I'd have loved to be in a fly on the wall in that recording session. I think it's so creative, the sounds, some of the drum sounds particularly. It's just brilliant, and I guess that helped shape as well, like just even giving it a go. You know, even just trying to get somewhat as creative as that would be just good.
It's funny how, I mean, it's a testament to Radiohead, and I'm such a huge fan, but I think that if Kid A, and that's you, for you it's OK Computer, for me it's Kid A, but if that record were to come out today, with all the electronic music that's out there now, I still think that Kid A would be mind-blowing to anyone. And that record is, 16 years old? 15 or 16 years
something
old?
Something like that.
And that's OK nuts. Computer. I know, it's crazy. I bought that from HMV on CD. I was in high school. Anyway, that's really great. And I'm glad that we now have on camera exactly that process, because I do remember you talking to me about it. And there's that, plus there's been some other thoughts and stuff I've heard that is encouraging me more to either during those sessions or afterwards, after the band has gone home, to do these things, whether it's just to get us excited about the mixing process or it's to actually have these records be different than the millions of other recordings out there.
Yeah, something I've recently done, if you're interested in hearing another one.
Of course.
Which I'd never tried before, but I heard on the internet, I forget who, some tutorial or some studio tour or something.
Yeah.
Was it a kick drum? We can all chuck a sample of if you need to really beef your kick up.
Yeah.
I have Trigger. Yeah. It has tons of sub kicks in it, but they're not the same kick that you've just recorded. So
totally.
What I did was, I think it was just basically a version of what I'd heard on got my TLM 102 out.
Okay.
Got the kick sound that I was trying to sort of beef up.
Yeah.
Turned my speakers off, put my TLM 102 in front of my sub.
Oh, wow.
And created sort of my own sub.
That's cool.
Kick by just standing over there being very quiet while it just sort of played through.
Did you play back the kick naturally, or did you EQ it? Did you low pass it at all, or?
I think I boosted. Yeah. I think I boosted the bottom end a bit.
Was the desk rattling?
It didn't. No. I mean, it's not crazy loud either.
Yeah, that's true. It doesn't need to be.
Yeah, I didn't do it crazy loud or anything. So you just
is it good?
It's cool. Great, and it's sub frequencies created by the kit. So it's maybe Trigger would be just as good, but I just wanted to try something like that, and I thought it sounded cool, and it really worked.
Yeah,
so no, that's great.
Another trick I've been doing, I don't know if it's a trick, and I don't know where it came from, but I know that amp blending is really popular, and I'm a big fan of amp blending because I just think that, you know, a 57 on a guitar, it's great, and you can maybe double that, play it twice. But if it's a beautiful solo on a beautiful guitar, I like to get as many mics in the room and as many amps and sounds as possible.
Right.
So one thing, we were doing guitars for a whole week for this one record, and every night we were coming in and doing a couple tunes. And the guy who was playing the guitar had a Strymon Big Sky as the last pedal in his chain, mm-hmm. and that's a stereo pedal. And so we had an orange amp that he brought, which is a great sounding tube amp. And then I had a Vox, we weren't using that. I have this this shitty amp I was telling you about before. It's a Sears amp, and it's 10 watts. Do you know how many watts that is, Jay? Have you seen it? I don't know.
It's either 10 or 5.
Yeah. But anyway, I got it for $10, and it's the thing's got to be 20 or 30 years old. And But it is like just pure like fuzz and grit.
Yeah.
And so what I did was, because he's got stereo out from his reverb, I sent one to the orange.
Yeah.
And then I sent another one to the Sears. And they were on opposite ends of the room, and I had a couple of gobos in between them. And then I think I did a ribbon and a 57, or a ribbon and an SM7 on both.
Yeah.
Plus I had a 414 in the room. And so we ended up having like, and then I actually even had one of my trash headphones taped to the back of the amp with the phase
inverter. That's quite a few mics.
It was a lot, but I knew that this was for a whole record.
Yeah.
And it was the same guitar, same amp, same guitar. So it was something I really, and it's a big part of the record. But it was game changing. And then mixing.
So you
pan them.
And it was beautiful. Much work,
beautiful. Yeah. And then I took the room mic and I just put it where it sounded the best.
Was the 414 Omni?
It was, yeah.
Yeah.
Or, yeah, I can't remember what I did with that, actually. But that was great, too. And I sometimes I took, I'd actually put, like, a really short delay on that room mic.
Yeah.
And, 100% or 50% on that room mic. And I don't know, I was just so happy with that sound. But, you know, that, again, it's right there. It's like thinking outside the box instead of just one guitar into an amp with the 57.
Yeah.
And it was just lush.
Yeah, and the different sort of different amps on different sides.
Totally, you know, yeah.
Play different with the delays.
And I bet you, if you're in an apartment building and you've got just like, you don't have amps or you're just trying to make a record, I bet you if you threw on a delay and a reverb plugin, you could get close to that sound. But it was exciting. It was fun.
Yeah.
You know?
It's the, I guess it's, you hear it all the time, but it is something about the air and the mm-hmm. distance you get.
I know.
A little bit of hum as well, that sort of stuff. I reamp a lot, even vocals.
Really?
Yeah, a lot.
That's cool.
I reamp the reverb to vocals a lot.
Hmm.
So I'll get a reverb, even from good plugins, like some of the UAD stuff. I have a, it's not up there, but I have the EMT 140.
Right.
I might get a reverb sound that I think is, this is good, it's great. Yeah. Not like a crazy reverb sound, but just maybe the first to create the ambience before you get into like height and depth and walls and things. And then I'll keep it in mono if I'm reamping, but then I'll send that wet, 100% wet,
mm-hmm.
out to my Vox.
Oh, cool.
And again, it creates another level of graininess.
Totally.
To it, and then I'll mic it, and that will create a bit more distance if I want or whatever. It's like it's little things like that. It is time consuming, but say for the lead vocal, it's like pretty important.
Yeah.
And then I may other stuff, maybe a bit more standard, maybe sort of plugins. But I've done Vox delays, reamped, and
I feel like stuff just stands out better. It's heard more when it's gone through that process, and you've added.
It definitely does. It definitely does create a uniqueness. And not that many people would, I don't know, people just hear it and they just, their reaction to the music is, I like this. It just makes me feel good. And that's what, when it's all worthwhile. They may have said that, you know, don't get me wrong. The song is the most important thing.
Yeah.
So
totally.
If you hadn't done that, and it was a great song, they would have still said, "This sounds great, and I feel good."
Yeah.
Well, then that's great. But it's our job. Someone's written a song. We've then tried to record it to the best of our ability, and then we're still trying to be creative, and I guess serve the song to. I don't want to use a cliche, but
it's totally true. Yeah. And I think there's no kid on Spotify who's listening to a track and be like, man, it sounds like he reamped that vocal reverb.
Yeah.
But you're, like a chef, it's our job to, like you say, just to make somebody who's enjoying a dish, they may not know anything about the ingredients, but they know they love it. And so I think the same way. I think people listen to our tracks and, and they gives them some sort of feeling.
Yeah. And sometimes we burn it and we throw it away, but they never hear that version.
Yeah, yeah. True. Yeah.
We like cook it again until like, yeah. send a new one out.
So I want to talk about some of this here. When I emailed you, you know, I love gear and we look at a lot of gear. And when we were talking in email, you were mentioning that you don't have a lot of gear. And I know that I bought a piece off of you. And at that time you were selling the ISA-1 and
yep.
I got the 610 off of you. But I really wanted to come out because you're running a studio primarily off of the Apollo. And I think this is really interesting. I said to you off camera that I'm very close to picking up an Apollo, primarily because of peer pressure. Like every studio we go to has an Apollo. But talk to me about this transition that you've had moving to the Apollo. You do have a Mikey. I've seen one of these before. That's really cool. Yeah. That's a bit of a channel strip, is it?
Yeah, it is. Although it doesn't have EQ, but okay. Yeah, it has a pre. Then it has a comp sat section.
Yeah.
With drive, you can bypass the compressor completely.
Okay.
So you can just get some saturation. Again, when I'm mixing, I use this a lot. Even just taking out a vocal, putting it through that, getting it nice. It's got warm and toasty. I mean, it's a great. Right. The way that the Empirical Labs do their gear is brilliant. Like
yeah,
nuke.
Yeah.
So this has the nuke setting on the compressor as well.
Okay.
So it's based on the Distressor.
Yeah.
It's a hybrid of the what is it? The EL9,
Fatso?
Which is the Fatso.
Yeah.
The EL8, which is the
Distressor,
yeah.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's
so this
it's
is saturation.
Brilliant. Yeah, so that's
okay, cool.
That's saturation, that's the drive. So in 1-to-1 it's pretty much like no compression. You can just increase the drive, get some saturation going. And the high frequency emphasis, if you put that in,
yeah,
it boosts the high frequencies.
Okay.
And it'll then soft clip them. So it boosts them, you get some nice saturation.
Hmm.
And then it cuts them afterwards as well. So
that's cool.
Pretty cool feature.
Yeah, I've seen one of these before. And I mean,
and then you can mix it. So it's got a blend. It's absolutely brilliant. It's got really good headroom. It sounds brilliant for bass guitar. So, you could effectively, because you can get some nice tape style saturation.
Yeah.
If you got, someone gave you a session to mix. So this is what happens with me. People say, oh, could you mix this session? You can hear like it's not been recorded on tape,
right,
or it's maybe
right.
not got gone through tons of amazing gear.
Yeah.
Just running a few things out through this and putting some saturation on it, duplicating stuff and nuking it, like nuking the mono rim mic with that sort of distress. It's not exactly like the Distressor, but it's...
That's cool.
Like... this is one of the pieces of gear. I don't see much written online about it, really. Like you.
No, it's true. It's not very...
But I wouldn't get rid of it. I use it
cool.
all the time. There's a few things I wouldn't get rid of. This, my 101 and my Vox. Like,
yeah.
I just... Yeah. And that is it's one of those
cool.
pieces for me.
The Apollo. So, you know, I was so hesitant to get this because it's so darn expensive. And
yep.
and it's a trap to have you buy all of this, which it looks like you've fallen into this trap.
Oh, I was in before I got the
okay.
I got Apollo.
So what? I mean, first of all, what made you decide to go that route?
Well, my hand was forced in a way. I was on a system where I was running a laptop, Snow Leopard,
okay,
Logic 9. So that was like. The most stable that those two things have been, the
right.
sort of the OS and Logic. And an Apogee Ensemble.
The silver one?
The silver one, yeah FireWire.
Okay.
Because my laptop was 2010, so it was FireWire. So as I said earlier off camera, it was a really good lesson. I learned a lesson in maintaining a studio. I procrastinated buying a new interface, and
right.
I just stayed on the system for so long until I couldn't have any updates, and actually my computer started playing up. So I needed to basically get a new Mac.
Right.
And now they're Thunderbolt.
Right.
So I could have used the
dongle or
the the converter. Apple.
Okay.
But they also stopped supporting the FireWire.
Oh, so you would have had to gone to an older OS.
Yeah.
Right.
Which you bought this with El Capitan.
Right.
Is that new?
Yeah.
Even though at the time everyone was saying it was buggy, I had no choice. Like, I think I could have maybe gone to Maverick if I'd got someone else to.
Right.
Apple wouldn't do it. So I was just in for a bit of a bumpy road for a while.
Yeah.
And actually now it's pretty good. So, yeah, so that was basically obsolete by buying a new computer.
Yeah.
So I was naturally going to, I loved this ensemble. It was really good. I loved the sound of it. I looked at the new one, which is also very expensive.
Yeah.
And then it was around Christmas time, the Apollo came out. I was already using the satellite. So I got that satellite when I bought my LA 610 Mark II that you now have.
So you should have given this to me.
Yeah. I hid it when you came into the studio.
And is that, would that be called like a duo or a quad?
Yeah, so that's a duo.
A duo,
so,
okay.
Yes, satellite. So I was already in and I was using the plugins and they sounded great. So I needed a new interface. Then it was around Christmas time. The Apollo came up for sale, the Apollo 8, and you get a free quad Thunderbolt.
A free quad?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So that was like a great deal.
Totally.
So I don't know what they are, 1,300 or something like
that.
You know, and I was at that stage where I was like, I've really got to upgrade everything. This isn't, I can't do this in increments in a nice way. This is going to sting no matter what I do. So, you know, I am running a business, like I want to sound the best I can.
Totally.
So I'll just go for it. That was a deal breaker. I was using a lot of plugins I really enjoyed using, and to get a quad effectively now. See, this is a duo Apollo. So now I've got 8 chips.
This is a duo. So,
yeah,
okay.
So it's basically, yeah.
2 and then 4 here.
Yeah, and then 2.
Okay, cool. Continue. I lost my train of thought, but go ahead.
Yeah, so I bought that. And you now find me at a place where I don't actually have many preamps.
I was
going
to say, was it difficult to let that 610 go and the ISA?
I did really like that unit, and sometimes I do. I miss it.
You haven't replaced it.
No, I know. I should stick my wish list up there, shouldn't I? Like print out like an API or.
If you want, I'll take a picture of it and email it so you can print it off.
but I always, I mean, my ideal unit in that same ballpark would have been the 6176, which
is... Oh, right, the 1176.
Yeah, which is 610 into the 1176. Right.
It's a little bit more expensive.
It is more. That would have... At the time, that was maybe what I would have loved, but I couldn't quite afford it. And,
yeah.
So it was a good unit, but when I got this, it comes with the Unison 610B.
Right. And so from a guy using both.
Yeah, so I did. Mm-hmm. I obviously naturally did. Being the geek I am, got out the mic and did some tests. And there, if I'm completely honest, there was a little difference.
Yeah.
But what I decided was, you know, at the stage I was at, the room that this is, it's more like a sort of a production recording suite.
Yes, right.
It's not like bands every day are walking in here recording drum kits, 15, 20 mics sort of thing.
Right.
It was such a small difference. And let's be honest, that isn't a massively high-end. It's a good
pre,
but it's not massively high-end, is it?
It's true.
So,
because it's 2-in-1.
Yeah, and even sort of like the price range, I was like, it's such a small difference that what I would be better off doing, which I had been thinking for some time, rather than keep going out looking for preamps on Kijiji or whatever, I would be better off getting the Apollo, learning to use the Unison plugins really well, selling some of the other gear for a while, and investing in better microphones so that my mic choice, you know, can be better, you know, like, you know, record at the source a bit better.
Yeah, that's so, cool.
So this, as we were saying earlier, this December, I think it's, I'm interested in the WA87
well,
normal.
I'm really interested in that too. Let's go in on it together. Let's get two and
see if
we can get a deal.
I mean, that's not massively, you could argue that that isn't massively high in microphone, but that's interesting to me, as well as, you know, I'd like to pick up some really high-end pencil condensers.
Yeah.
Maybe. I think that's a good
great idea.
Way to sort of invest. Well, that was, I felt, good for me at the time. And I sold my ISA1.
Yep.
Because
you still had that when I was here.
Yeah. Again, it did add something. It has a little more roundness than maybe the Apollo. It's just a bit different, and I liked it. But I have to say, it's good preamp. But then the Apollo pre's these are good. They've been a step up, I think, from the older ones from what I hear.
Yeah.
But then when you put the Unison plug-in on it, it beat the ISA. So I was like, well, again, I feel like I needed a reset.
Yeah.
So I got rid of those. I kept my my key. And now I'm looking to just expand my Apollo with another like four channel pre.
Okay.
So that I can straight away, I've got access here to the four Unisons and then through the line ins.
Oh, I see.
Eight. Maximizing the 8 channels. So I was like, again, warm audio looking at,
yeah, like
they've got the API clone four, what's it, the 4-1
3124.
That's interesting. That could be good. I mean, and then I'm set up 8 channels, you could record a drum kit pretty easily.
No, that's great.
You know, and that's the way to expand the
710, the one we were talking about earlier, the 4710, the Twinfinity UA, or whatever that is, the UA one. That's an interesting option too, because then it would expand you an additional four. I mean, in this room, you're probably not doing a lot of 12 channels at a time, but it's interesting because you do get four good pre's and then an extra four channels.
That has optical, doesn't it?
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah,
so you would be up to 12, but 12 inputs with that. But I don't know. I don't know what how the 710 compares to the 610. Because I think, you know, it's the blend of the solid state and the two.
That's right. You can blend each one, can't you?
Yeah.
I have used one.
I don't know.
A guy came and used one here. They sound good, but.
Yeah, I've used a while. So, okay. So with this, now here's some of the questions that I have. I'm interested in the API Vision, the Vision channel strip.
Yeah.
So have you used that a lot to track with? And do you use it like on the way in?
Yeah, I have.
What are your thoughts with that?
Well, it sounds great. it's obviously really versatile.
Because, I mean, I can't get over, actually, like, is this a retina screen, by the way?
Yeah, it's 4K.
Okay. Yeah. My gosh. It's beautiful. So the thought with this channel strip is to get that API equipment in hardware would be extremely expensive. I mean, you're probably at $4,000 or $5,000 for what we see there. And you've got it four times, right?
Yeah.
Unison. So.
Or as many times as you want in the mix.
In the mix,
depending on how many chips you have.
So what's that like to track with? And are you aggressive with the stuff like the gate or the compressor? Will you track with the gate or the compressor?
Yes, I have done. I would use. For vocals, it's relatively gentle.
Okay.
I would use a compression. Normally, just to catch the peaks.
Right. So nothing you'd ever regret?
Yeah. Because what I like to do in the mix on vocals is use, another level of compression, which is why I take it easy throughout the whole process.
Mm.
I like to use 1176, fast attack, fast release, no more than like maybe 4 dB, just like to catch the peaks, and then go into the LA2A, something like that, for that much smoother. I might just, this just sort of tidies it up on the way in. Like, no, I don't know, like maybe like two or three.
Yeah.
Like just gentle. Yeah. Depending on the type of vocal, obviously, like with the gate, if it can take a gate nicely, then right. I would. If not, that's whatever, you can clean it up afterwards. But mainly, mainly I would push the gain.
Oh, okay.
You know, to get that
to
nice,
get it closer to the preamp.
Yeah, to get that nice sort of saturation.
And if you're recording like electrics or something or a snare, would you use EQ on the way in?
Yeah, yeah, I would use EQ on a vocal if it needed. But the downside to the EQ, which some people bring up, is that it's only 2 dB steps.
Right. Yeah.
I've never found that like really, really annoying. just be gentle with it, and then. Yeah. And then add to it later on in the right. process. But for guitars, I would be much more aggressive with the compressor and the gate and the EQ.
Really?
Yeah.
That's cool.
If it, you know, I feel like a guitar can
and what
take
about,
it a bit
what about
more
the filters? Do you use those in recording?
Yep. I use these, well, depending on what mic it is, I would use the high pass for sure. You definitely use a high pass for guitars.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really use a low pass, but high pass I would. You know, just for due diligence and all that.
Like
even what's good with the Unison is if you we're recording. I won't do it now because I'll muck it up. But if you press and hold the preamp knob here, these turn orange.
Okay,
and they work the, it's like the gain stages on the pre's.
So
it's
cool.
It's basically one way to, I guess, satisfy some of the guys that
tangible,
were
tangible tactile.
Yeah, the tactile.
Can you control everything with it?
No, it's mainly like gains.
Oh, okay, cool.
Gain stage. So you can do, like, and then when you press it again, once it's in that mode, you press it again, and it shuffles around the various options that you can change.
Oh, that's nice.
So you can do gain, and so very quickly, if you keep it in that mode very quickly, you know, even when the vocalist is in, you can be doing this.
Yeah.
Which is nice, rather than,
where's
my mouth?
Well, it's like, funny, actually, with the API, I have the 550 from Waves, the plugin from Waves, and I hate using it with a mouse because it's like up for the volume and side to side for the frequency, I think, on the Waves, like it's really difficult to dial in a sound.
Yeah, I mean,
using
you even get a little bit of that with these, but I mean, that's just the way that the...
Just the design of the two and one.
Yeah, design of the original thing, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
But
so you had said about 1176 on the vocals. Do you do that in tracking?
Yes, sometimes I do, because obviously the vision strip would be one route I would go down. Another one would be, if I wasn't going to use compression, I might create a change. So I was talking about the unit that I really wanted.
Yes.
Which is, again, another reason to sell some of the gear was now I have that.
Yeah.
If I want, I can have the LA 610 Mark II.
Totally.
If I want the 6176, well, I just bring up the 610D
and then
put the 1176 behind it.
Yeah.
Then even put an LA-2A afterwards or whatever if I was feeling like I wanted to do that. But yeah, I use the 1176.
Because I guess you do have to make a bit of those decisions to save on CPU. I mean, otherwise you just record everything dry and then put those in afterwards. But that would start to use up the chips you have, right?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's decision-making, isn't it?
Yeah.
It helps you make decisions. But I mean, I'm not like, I don't go crazy on stuff. If I was like reamping something or messing around with a room mic or recording a simple drum setup, I might go crazy on what I call the fun mics.
Right.
You know, I've got like a contact PZM contact mic.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I might
totally
tape to the same, glass door. Or
thing I would do. Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah, so I would go kind of crazy on that. But there's no way I would like absolutely crush a vocal unless that was the actual, you know, the exact sound I wanted.
Yeah.
I'm much more like, just like I said earlier, don't screw it up.
Yeah,
just
totally.
Just make it, you know, just tame it a little bit, get it in the box. And,
yeah. So what's one of your favorites out of the UAD stuff?
So much.
Everything we have open here.
Well, yeah, the Fairchild is pretty good. That's really nice on the mixed bus.
Yeah.
Maybe a bit surprising, the LA-3A.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've heard that.
That's not even been revamped.
I've heard it's that, still, yeah.
I just like it. I like it on guitars. I like it on vocals. I like it on drums. Hmm. If I'm thinking, if it gets to a point where, you know, the running out of DSP or whatever,
yeah,
I'll happily use the LA-3A, which is, it's not as intense.
Less DSP,
intense.
Yeah.
It's just really good. The de-esser, the precision de-esser,
okay,
I use a lot. I used to use the Waves de-esser a fair bit.
Yeah.
And the UAD one is great. I use that a lot. At the end of a vocal chain, just slightly.
That's cool.
And probably Ocean Way.
Right. I'm curious to hear that. A lot of people talk about that. Do you find, so you have a lot of DSP here. Do you feel like you have enough?
Yes. I would say yes. I've convinced myself I have.
Yeah.
Because
do you ever run out?
I was doing a mix a couple of months ago when I ran out, but that was because at the same time I was doing some stuff where I was adding to the mix on top, like I was adding some synths.
Oh, okay.
I'd been sent them to mix, but I had some ideas, and
right,
they were like, "Yes, kind of do your thing."
Yeah.
So I had on the console, which you bring up, is the basically the desk for the Apollo. I had the spring reverb.
Okay.
The, what is it? The
AKG?
Yeah, the AKG, yeah. BX20, isn't it?
Right, yeah, I'm not sure.
Which is a phenomenal sounding, like, spring reverb. It seems so easy to, like, get great sounds. I would have loved to have actually used an original.
Right.
But this is fantastic.
Yeah.
So I had those on two auxes. Panned.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Like kind of hard left, yeah, hard right. And that uses a lot through console, used it a lot of DSP.
Right.
But I was recording, I was printing that.
Right.
So I'd made the decision to print it.
Cool.
So they were just on there.
Yeah.
And then I ran out of DSP in the actual session.
Because one of the reasons I'm asking is the promo that's going on right now, and when this video is out, we'll know what decision I made. But
yeah.
The promo that's going on right now, you get
the quad,
right?
Yeah, and it's like, the same as I had, effectively.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And so what's interesting is that, I mean, this unit here is almost $3,000, and we're talking Canadian prices here.
Yeah.
And then that has a resale value of, you know, maybe $800 to $1,000. And so thinking budget-wise, and I mix a lot with Slate and with some other, sound toys and some of the stock stuff. So I'm wondering, and I won't make this decision quickly, but it'd be interesting to sell that to help pay for the unit. I mean, there's got to be people here who would buy this and just to get this for free and then turn around and sell their Apollo.
Yeah.
It's such maybe a great deal.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
What are you
on at the moment? Do you have any plugins? You don't even.
No, I don't. I don't have any UAD satellites.
And you're getting you're buying the Duo. Or
yes, will you get the Duo. Quad? Yeah, no, the Duo. Yeah.
Yeah, so you'll have six. Yeah, so you won't be far off what I have. I only have a couple of extra.
So the question would be, should I sell the quad satellite?
Well, what will happen is,
I'll have to buy it later.
yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You have to buy it back.
Yeah.
What will happen is, you would have spent this great money on an Apollo. So you might as well use some of the Unison features it has.
Yeah.
So you might buy a rather nice pre,
right,
you know, like a pre-channel strip, yep. Unison-enabled channel strip. Yep. Then you'll realize, oh, this sounds great. I can use it also in the mix regularly. Yep. Like, you, sometimes I might not put stuff on every channel, but I mix through stems.
Oh, okay.
So then I might put something like the channel strip on a stem or the or you know, like the tape.
Right.
On different stems, right. Things like that. Even that, you know, you start totally. Using these totally. Things more and more. So
yeah.
If you want to, if your way in is to like sell something so it's been not so much money, then that's, you know, like right, fair right. enough. But you will for sure use it.
Totally. Like, well, I have a buddy who's had an Apollo now for about 3 or 4 months. So I'll see what he says. He doesn't have the quad. He didn't get the promo at the time.
Yeah.
But I'll see if he's getting close to, because we use a lot of the same plugins. He likes a lot of the Slate stuff and some Waves and soft tubes. So I'll see if he feels like he's running out.
Yeah.
Because that's interesting.
I'm sort of, I guess I could upgrade and get like a quad Apollo or whatever, but I feel like it's like with everything, sometimes limitations are good.
Oh, yeah.
So
oh,
I feel sure. like yep. with the stuff that I can run, it's all great stuff. Like any more, and I feel like it just, more decisions, more plugins Agreed. To choose from.
Agreed.
So I feel like I already had that anyway.
Yeah.
I'm just going to sort of freeze myself here for a while and just learn to use what I have.
So when it comes to Unison Pre's, you have the 610
and the API.
Have you used the Neve?
I've used the 1073.
Right.
That sounds great. I use that on the vocal. I also have the Neve 88 RS.
Okay, I'm
the
not sure
legacy
that.
Version though. They've just revamped it to Unison.
Oh,
apparently
yes,
it sounds amazing.
That. Yeah.
But I've used the legacy version more in like the broadcasting stuff.
Yeah.
So I would potentially get the Neve because it's Black Friday.
Oh yeah, that's right.
I have to say, although I have this and the quad.
Yeah.
And the plugins, I've never bought anything full price. It's a great thing about UAD. They're like, I got this ridiculously cheap because they threw like a $50 voucher my way and then another $50 voucher for some reason because I hadn't shopped for a while. It's like, hey, come back and shop with us.
Here's another. Wow.
Then it went on a crazy sale. It was the June.
Right, because they have the spring one. Yeah,
I pick it up for like next to nothing. So. If you're just patient and you know what you want, you do not need to pay full price. That's
right.
One way of keeping costs down. But
cool.
I'm not saying they're not worth it because they
no,
are.
No, no, I get that. It's the same way with Waves.
Yeah.
No, that's really cool. And it comes with a lot of stuff too in that legacy package or in the classics bundle.
Yeah, you get the, is it classics bundle? Yeah. And with this one, you also get a couple of guitar pedals. You get really good that you can use Unison.
Oh, okay. That's cool.
You get soft tube amp room. I think you get a bass Ampeg.
Oh, okay.
Which is really good.
Cool.
And you get the precision rack, which has the sort of like EQ.
Yeah, I've seen that.
That's kind of useful if you.
They just came out with some bus compressors too.
Yeah. See, I was thinking about getting another pre until they brought out the API 2500.
Yeah.
But you know. See that?
It's crazy, eh?
Yeah.
It's cool. Well, you know what? It's so much fun, and I've said this a couple times before about Slate, and the same thing is with UAD and a lot of those other guys, even the independents. But it makes it fun. I find it's enjoyable. I think we all could make great mixes without it, and some of us should get better at using stock stuff. But at the end of the day, to me, like this is. It's also a hobby. It's sometimes, you know, it's a career in one way, but it's also a hobby. So it's fun. It's fun to see what new products they come out with. And
yeah. And it's a way into the world because of these units that I never got to use. I mean, who gets to use a Fairchild?
Yeah. Like, oh, for sure.
Maybe a handful of the biggest studios in the
totally.
World. They're a way into understanding the gear and how it worked and how it reacts to audio and, the amazing things you can do with it.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, you know, you go and Google like other people that have used it and, you know, like the other mix engineers that we look up to.
Yeah.
Mix with the masters and all that.
Yeah.
You get into like, you know, what do they, what records are mixed on an API. Mm-hmm. It's just an interesting way into the old sort of analog world. And to be honest, it's sometimes the only way into that world now, because, I mean,
totally.
Partly, all the big studios seem to be closing left, right, and center.
Right. Well, and also I think too is if you go on using an LA-2A through UAD for 10 years or 20 years, and your career is building up and your studio is building up, I think you can more confidently buy a $4,000 hardware unit when you know that you've gotten comfortable with it and you've kind of cut your teeth on the digital version.
Yeah.
You know, as opposed to being 19 years old and buying a $5,000 compressor.
Yeah. And who can do that?
No, exactly. Well, listen, thanks a lot, Mark, for letting us come by. And you know, when I kid you not, when I was out here last year getting the LA-610 from you, I was in the process of thinking about this series and thinking about coming out to visiting studios. And so when I was standing in here, I was thinking, man, if we ever do this video series, I want to come back out here because it's a great place. I know that you've built this half a garage, you've customized it for what you do, and being attached to where you live, I think it's such a great environment. So I was really hoping I'd be able to come out here and talk longer.
Great to have you guys.
Yeah, I really appreciate it.
Maybe you come back next year when I've expanded my
No, it's great.
I'll have racks.
Yeah,
I said I wasn't going to buy anything, but I'll have like two racks full of Prees or something.
We always stop ourselves. I've actually been that way right now recently with vinyl. Honestly, 3 months ago, I've been like, no more vinyl. This year, I've bought way too much vinyl. And then like a new record will come out or I'll find something. But one of the things I want to mention to the people that are watching for Mark's work is I'm a huge fan of Fitness Club Fiasco. And that record that you made, this whole relationship started with when I emailed you on Kijiji looking for this hardware piece. And when I saw the name come back, I was like, man, that name looks familiar. And it turns out you produced and engineered the Fitness Club Fiasco record. So remind me to put a link in there for Modern Thought, because I love that record. And it's a producer and engineer's dream record. It's beautiful. There's so many things going on.
It was a dream record, I guess, because the songs are great.
They are, yeah.
Like, it was so much fun to hang out with all those guys. And Mike and Matt Henderson, well, they were over kind of all the time. You know, they were working jobs and going to college and all kinds of things. They put in a lot of effort over the few years.
Sonically, it's such a beautiful record, and I love it. So I'm definitely going to put some links to it, because I want people to, you know, I hope that people, when they watch videos like this, they check out the work that the engineers that were in the studios that we're featuring do. But I mean, that record is, I was like excited to come meet you after hearing that record.
Oh, great. Oh, thanks. I'm glad you.
I really appreciate it. Thanks a lot, man.
Thank you.
Take care.